Well, for me, it is an honor to welcome this extraordinarily talented person to the stage.
Thank you.
I'm going to start with a few questions about the acting part of your career. Every time I watch the clips from Leon the Professional, I'm reminded of what a sense of discovery we all had seeing you in that. How did you, at the age of 12 or whatever, get cast by Luc Besson, who, by the way, was our guest here in Real Pieces about 3 years ago, together with Michelle Yeoh for The Lady? How did you get cast as Matilda?
Well, thank you for saying that. And I really wanted to act as a kid. It's funny how you know things at 11 that you know for the rest of your life. I think now that I'm obviously much older and have talked to so many people who have passions like I do, they all say they knew it around that same age. And I begged my parents to let me audition for things, and they kindly agreed. And then that was the first thing I got. And I could have, I feel like I auditioned for like a lot of like cereal commercials and things like that, but it was never like an adorable, like, you know, wholesome kid or anything. Obviously, I did kind of dark things.
Well, I mean, also, it is an American action film. Gary Oldman is in it too, but it has a very European flair, nuances, and there's this, you know, beautiful ambiguity in terms of the relationships, the way that your character is drawn to Jean Reno, such a wonderful actor. And he's playing a role not unlike the one that he played in Luc Besson's La Femme Nikita, mm-hmm. you know, a previous film, a cleaner, you know, somebody who fixes things up by being a hitman. And for you, if that was your first role, your introduction to the world of filmmaking, how was it shaping you, the world of Luc Besson, which is a French-American thing, as opposed to had you started out with a typical American mainstream movie?
Yeah, I don't know that I definitely know how to compare it, because of course I only had one of those experiences, but it was certainly very influential to get to see how Luc placed the camera, because it was always in an unexpected place, and I think that's something that's so impressive with his films, is how beautifully shot they are. You know, we're so used to seeing sort of cookie cutter action movies, and his films are always unexpected in the way they look. And then I think also getting to watch Jean act, because I didn't know anything, and it's funny, like hearing the clips and just like my elocution is so precise. It's like very strange. I like really enunciate my T's. And watching Jean, who was so like minimalist with what he did, and so naturalistic, I think really affected what I wanted to do after watching him.
Sure. And then I love Beautiful Girls. It's this ensemble piece that not that many people know. It was directed by Ted Demme, who passed away not that long afterwards.
Yeah, very young.
Yeah, and from a wonderful script by Scott Rosenberg. And it's an ensemble piece that has a lot of different characters, Uma Thurman, and I can't even remember half of them by now, but you have only 5 scenes in the film, all of them with Timothy Hutton, another actor I've admired ever since Ordinary People. And yet you establish such a rich character.
Thank you.
An old soul, I think Marty is. Were you yourself around that time, 13, 14, as kind of precocious and wise as the character you play?
It's funny because I think people might have said that, but I wasn't. Like, I was a big pretender, I think. I didn't understand half the words I was saying. I remember in that scene you showed, I kept saying, when I said my line, penitentiary, and they had to like keep telling me it's penitentiary, penitentiary. And I was like, it was really, you know, I could put on a good show that I was an adult, but I was not very mature.
But actually, what comes across is this wonderful tension between how young the character is and how much older she really wants to be.
Right.
And as you're skating and, you know, sort of weaving your little web around Timothy Hutton's character, I just, you know, how does one not fall in love with that particular...
Well, that is a good description of how I was, is that I always wanted to be older, and I was always very immature. This the same.
And they end the scene with him wondering what you'll be like in 5 years, and then, of course, we show a clip that's more like 8 years later, but boy, are you different and closer.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing that film and being kind of shocked in a way, partly because it's a dark film directed by Mike Nichols, adapted from the play. You received an Oscar nomination for Best Supporting Actress for playing that tough-seeming stripper. And this is a film that has all these romantic permutations, like a chamber piece, among Julia Roberts, Clive Owens, Jude Law, and your character. Did you find it really hard, after playing these very sympathetic characters, to play that character?
It was definitely daunting, I think, to have... I think it was the first time I worked with that level of material. I mean, the Patrick Marber script is, I think, one of the best sort of pieces ever written about adult relationships. And it's really, really like kind of a classic piece of text. The lines are so perfect. And the cast was incredible, and I was really, and of course, Mike Nichols, the greatest ever directing. So to be in that company, I really was feeling like I needed to step up to the task. And but also having all of those things at your fingertips, those words, those actors opposite you, that guidance, it's also kind of keeps you afloat.
Sure. In terms of guidance or maybe inspiration, I'm curious whether at that earlier stage in your career or even now, there have been particular actors, male or female, that you have looked towards for that sense of, not necessarily influence, but this is the kind of work I want to do.
Oh, absolutely. You know, we talked about earlier on backstage about doing The Seagull in Central Park, and when I was 19, which was also directed by Mike Nichols, and that experience was so amazing because we had a rehearsal process all together with this incredible cast, including Meryl Streep and Philip Seymour Hoffman and Kevin Kline and Christopher Walken, Marcia Gay Harden, goes on and on, John Goodman, like really incredible people. And I think it was certainly a huge influence to watch Meryl working during rehearsals and then on stage. And I would go run around when I wasn't in a scene with her. I would run around. They have in Central Park, they call them VOMs, which is a word I learned, but they're sort of these sort of like runways that go down underneath the audience from the stage. And I guess they used to call it that because it was where people would go vomit when they would like drink too much in the theater, I think. But I think that's a long time ago, and I hope it's fine. But I would like run around to the VOMs because you could watch from there without anyone see you, and every night get to see all the different things she tried, every performance, and just like this spirit of searching and to see the preparation that she did ahead of time. I mean, she would invent songs that she could break out into that were seemed like Russian folk songs that she might be able to throw in one night, you know, things like that. And Phil Hoffman also, I absolutely just watched his process and saw, I would always like peek over his shoulder in his notebook and be like, what is he writing to himself? Because when you don't have, any formal training, it's, you know, you're just trying to steal from everyone you admire who you get to work with. And Phil, I also went to, I mean, I made the horrible mistake of reading reviews after our opening night, which is the worst possible idea when you're doing theater, because no matter what they say, you have to go on the next night and the next night and the next night and do the same thing. And so, of course, there were some positive and there were some negative, and only the negative ones stayed in my mind. And I was paralyzed and I didn't know how I could go on. And I went to feel like hysterical before a show and was just like, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? And he was like, you are not in school. You're doing this like on stage. It's like when I was your age, I was in school and I was trying things and making mistakes and no one had to see it. He's like, you just go out there. This is your school. Forget about them and just go do it. And it was really helpful to make me feel like, okay, maybe he did stuff that people thought was bad at one point. Of course, never in our lifetimes when watching him. But it was comforting to hear that from him. It was very generous.
Now, I think you were very lucky to, in your earlier part of the career, not only get to do quirky things like Leon the Professional, Beautiful Girls, but to work on stage with the likes of Mike Nichols and Meryl Streep. And I should also acknowledge, because maybe this very educated Real Pieces audience that we have may not be aware, that you also were in Star Wars, 3 of the prequels. Let me make sure I got the titles right. Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. Episode 2, Attack of the Clones. And Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. I have to read this because I never saw the films. And I confess this with great embarrassment because I'm too busy watching obscure foreign and independent films.
That's good.
To see the mainstream ones.
Evens it out.
But in preparation for tonight, Mark and I did actually watch some of this, and they were all directed by George Lucas. You know, we'll give credit where it's due. These prequels are among the highest grossing films of all time. So I do feel obligated to ask whether it is very different for an actor like you to do a mainstream big budget film versus a small independent one, or does one use the same muscles ultimately?
You know, it is the same muscles in some way, but it's also a very different beast at the same time. The Star Wars films were really surprising, I think, because it was the first time I had worked with green screen before, and it was almost exclusively green screen. And that is a challenge that is so much greater than like doing the most dramatic scene with like another actor in a room that looks like the room that you're supposed to be in. Because not only are you imagining your interior life, but you're imagining everything that's around you. And when you've never seen anything like that before, you really kind of lose track of where you are. And I always, when I see someone act well in one of those effects movie, I'm like, they're an incredible actor, because that's kind of the hardest. I mean, it's kind of like being a kid and saying this refrigerator box is my spaceship. So it requires a real level of imagination that is not required of the like indie art house film.
Sure. But even in something like V for Vendetta, which I had not seen when it came out, but again, to prepare for tonight, my husband and I watched it, and we were very, very impressed. You are doing most of your scenes there with Hugo Weaving, who's behind Guy Fawkes' mask. And I'm wondering if, for an actor, is it more challenging to react to a masked face? I mean, to an actor whose face you cannot see.
Yeah, it's actually really fascinating to work with a mask. And the thing that I think wasn't that difficult for that film is that the character is also responding to a mask. All right. And so it's not like I had, you know, I found it harder in Star Wars to act opposite an X mark that later would become a monster, you know, than a mask that was always a mask.
On the other side is the scene that we showed from New York, I Love You, the segment directed by Mira Nair, which I've always had a very passionate relationship to. It takes place in the Diamond District on 47th Street, where my father was a jeweler, I might add. Your Rivka is an Orthodox diamond dealer who's about to get married. And when you're with Irfan Khan, one understands this very Jewish character that you are playing, a Hasidic bride. Given your own Jewish background, did this role have more of a personal resonance for you?
You know, it's such a different background Jew than I am, because I come from like the most secular Israeli background where, you know, like you go to the beach on Yom Kippur kind of family. So it's I think as much in my imagination as maybe a non-Jew what a Hasidic Jew would be like. But it was definitely a step forward, because my whole career being Jewish and you know, very publicly and proudly Jewish, I suppose, maybe compared to other actors, I get offered a lot of like all the like Jewish Holocaust related roles, and had not had never really wanted to play those, and this was something very I felt really different that I hadn't seen before, that was really unique, and I felt showed a kind of different aspect of the community.
And it is a kind of quietly shocking moment when Rivka removes her wig. And I read somewhere that this wonderful actor, Irfan Khan, said that when his character sees the shaved head, he sees it as an innocent diamond.
Mm-hmm.
And there is something about the vulnerability that both the character and the actor are revealing mm-hmm. in that motion. And then, of course, V for Vendetta, you know, you've got quite, we actually see your hair being shaved off, you know, so I imagine that's not easy for an actor.
Well, it was actually funny because I did the New York I Love You after, and they brought in these people from Saturday Night Live who are used to doing like bald caps and wigs. They put it on in like 5 minutes, literally, because they're so used to doing everything fast. And I was like, I shaved my hair on V for Vendetta, and they could have put it on in 5 minutes. It took me like 3 years of really awkward boy short hair growing it out. Anyway, too little, too late.
Okay, but if for those who have not seen V for Vendetta, it's, you know, it's wonderfully sort of revolutionary stuff, which may, by the way, have more of a political meaning today than when it was made. Because basically you have this demagogue, played by John Hurt, who is barking orders from a huge screen, preying on xenophobia, fear, and violence. And when I watched it this time, I thought, oh, I feel a shiver that is very contemporary.
Yeah. Yeah, it was based on a graphic novel by Alan Moore that was written during the Thatcher years in England. So, yes, unfortunately, these patterns do repeat.
Yeah, yeah. I won't go there further right now. Black Swan is a film that obviously we need to acknowledge before we move into your directing world. You won the Academy Award for Best Actress, and it's not a surprise. One of the things that struck me most when I saw it is that it's very hard while watching the film to know what is happening, quote, in reality, and what is taking place in Nina's hallucinations. And there are many very discomforting, dark scenes where I think we almost identify with the character's own lost sense of self. In fact, we showed a scene from the end. There, your arms seem to, you know, turn into bubble wrap, you know, sprouting those dark wings. And I had a few questions about this film. I mean, I know you studied ballet when you were 13, so obviously you were prepared for some level of the dancing. But given how Darrenofsky was working with this dark emotional material, what did you find most challenging about playing Nina? Was it more the physical dancing? Was it inhabiting this very vulnerable psychological space? And I also wanted to talk about the voice of Nina at one point, because that struck me too. But
yeah, well, I think both of the things were challenging, but in a really fun way. I really had the best time making that. It was, I really love dancing, and it was really, really great to do it. And I did train, of course, there's certain things like those turns at the end is a double. There's certain things you don't learn by doing, 8 months of training. And I had a wonderful double from ABT, Sarah Lane, who did the sort of footwork and turning and that sort of thing. But of course, there were other sequences that Benjamin, now my husband, choreographed, particularly so that I could do them, that, you know, there's a waltz sequence in the film that I do completely myself. And there's other things that I was able to do, and I really loved getting to learn how to dance in that way and learn all of the little details where they even coach you about where your eyes look and the tip, your fingertips, and that was really special. And then the acting was just amazing because I felt a real ease of communication with Darren, where he knew exactly what to say to me that would trigger a new version of what we were doing. And it was kind of a dream to get to work with a director in that way, who was so respectful, so collaborative, and also so just in tune with me that really could read how to work with me. And wait, there's another part that I'm forgetting.
The challenging aspect of either the psychological or the vocal aspect.
Oh, the vocal aspect, yes. So one thing I noticed when I was training and when I was talking to all these different dancers was that a lot of these women had very girly voices. And it was really interesting to me because it was actually something that Mike Nichols had pointed out to me about myself when I was working with him on Closer. He sent me to a vocal coach and everything because he said I was talking in a very high range and he thought I wasn't really speaking like an adult. And it was really interesting because there's a real infantilization of women in ballet. The heads of the companies usually refer to them as girls and the men as boys also, so it's not just the women. And I also realized that, you know, you always imagine a dancer with like no shape, like kind of having like a female dancer is having this sort of like boy body. And it's not the case. Like ballet doesn't do that. They're selected, that's like a taste, you know, that the girls who have big boobs don't get into the company. Hmm. Or, you know, they'll be in the company and then their boobs develop and they start not getting roles. And so there's a real like childlike thing. And to me, that was very much what the movie was about, you know, as an artist trying to please someone else, namely in the film, the director of the company, and then becoming a real artist when it becomes about pleasing yourself. Mm-hmm. And that being the progression and finding the voice was a big part of that, so that we would call it the white swan voice or the black swan voice. And when she was the white swan, she talked in this kind of high, yeah, you know, girly little girl voice. And then when the black swan came out, she was a woman.
Yeah. And I remember that Darren Aronofsky was on a panel I moderated at the Telluride Film Festival, and he cited as inspirations for Black Swan films that came as a shock to me, like Repulsion, and another Polanski film, The Tenant, and The Fly, David Cronenberg, and I'm thinking, these are dark things, and then I realized, well, yeah, the werewolf transformation,
right,
and the swan transformation, there is, unfortunately, deep, right, common material there.
I also recently watched Haneke's The Piano Teacher again, and I think that is a big inspiration when you watch it, even structurally, it feels very much an inspiration too.
Wow. The Piano Teacher, directed by Michael Haneke, is one of the darker films I've seen. I'm not exactly going to jump into recommending it for the moment. We mentioned in passing your stage work, you know, obviously The Seagull, which I was lucky enough to see. But your first major role on stage was The Diary of Anne Frank.
Yes.
directed by James Lapine.
Yes.
And you haven't really been doing that much stage work, and I think one of the main reasons is you get offered so many wonderful film roles, and then you end up directing yourself. Mm-hmm. But do you see yourself returning to the stage? Is that something that you still feel can be nurturing to you?
I would really love to. I actually have been dreaming about it a lot recently. It's been feeling to me like something that's really special, as it feels like not commodified, because it's not something you can like take home with you, or you're not trying to like trap time, which film is obviously like trapping time. It's like appreciating that we're in a moment, we're experiencing this now, and it's going to be gone in 2 hours, and there's something kind of magical about that. And so I've been really, really interested in that live performance aspect.
So maybe that'll happen if someone offers you the right part.
I would love to. In the right way, because I feel like stage, I mean, while it's not commodified in that way, there's, I mean, the Broadway versus like public theater, you know, dichotomy in New York is really vast and plays to such different audiences.
That's right. But then again, you have now added to your repertoire directing. And as a segue, I'm curious, because we've only shown a few clips of your work and even acknowledged only a few titles, but you've worked with Michael Mann in Heat, Tim Burton, that wonderful campy satire, Mars Attacks, Woody Allen, Everyone Says I Love You, Jim Sheridan with Brothers, Kenneth Branagh, who directed Thor, mm-hmm. in which you play, again, a mainstream film, but playing a scientist, Amos Gitai, the Wachowski siblings, Milos Forman for mm-hmm. Goya's Ghosts, Terrence Malick, Knight of Cups. I'm just rattling off a few people who I admire. Tom Tykwer, who directed you in the compendium film Paris, Je T'aime, Paris, I Love You, which is like New York, I Love You, in a segment called True. My question really is whether any of these directors were particularly important for you in terms of learning from them for your own directing.
Oh, absolutely. Many of them. I mean, I've been so lucky to get to work with, you know, 40 different directors over the years. As Mike Nichols would always say to me, you know, directing's like sex. You never know how anyone else does it. And maybe that's not true anymore, because we get to see a lot of other people having sex if we want to. But it's true that directors often, like the first thing they ask me when we start working on a movie, when I'm an actress, is what does Malick do? Or what does Woody Allen do? And they want to know about everyone else's, you know, style, because even if they get to visit, it's usually for a day. I mean, to make a complete film, you get to watch a director through entire production. It's really a gift. But to answer your question, I would say Anthony Minghella, even though I worked with him for only 10 days on Cold Mountain, a very small part, was very, very influential. He was the most emotionally connected director to everyone in the crew and in the cast. He would, like, the guy who was bringing snacks around, he like knew his children's names and asked about them. And with the actors, it always felt like he was a character in the scene, because he was just so emotionally with you. And he would do tricks like, have the actor opposite you when they were off screen change their line to elicit kind of a new reaction from you. And I used that when I was working. And I thought about him very, very often when I was working, because I aspire to that. I think it creates such an incredible onset energy when you feel that connectedness with everyone in the crew, and everyone in the crew knows how important they are. Nichols was my great friend and mentor, and he really focused always on story. He just always said, remind yourself what story you're telling, name the moments, name the beats of your story. This is the moment they fall in love. This is the moment they she realizes he's cheating on her. This is the moment he sees his mother as a flawed human being for the first time, that you name the big moments in the scene and that you remind your cast always what story you're telling. And Darren was amazing because he really was so specific with each actor. He really understood that every actor needs their own form of communication, and some people respond better to really positive reinforcement. Some people respond much better to criticism. Some people need to be left alone. Some people need you to ask them questions. So I tried to have that intuition, as he did, of tailoring direction, although, again, something to aspire to. And Malik, I worked with right before I started shooting my film as director, which was one of the luckiest coincidences of my life, because he is so free and just does his own thing that's not like anyone else does it, and keeps it kind of like guerrilla filmmaking. Like, you know, it's like 10 people, you hop in a van, you go to a location, you get out, you get back in, you change clothes, like you go do the scene again, the same scene in different clothes in a different place, and he'll figure out how to put it together. And he's just wild, and I love it. And he kept saying, you know, you make films your way. Don't let anyone else tell you that, you know, you need a three-act structure, or you need like an engine to get through it, or you just make, you know, movies as you experience life. You paint from life. And that was incredible to have right before I started.
Well, you've obviously learned from some of the masters, and Anthony Minghella, I remember him with such fondness. He was our guest in Real Pieces with the film Breaking and Entering, although I suspect most of you remember him from The English Patient. That's probably his most famous film, and both he and Mike Nichols are no longer with us, but fortunately Darren Aronofsky is.
Yes.
Well, in case you're wondering how in the world you'd ever be able to see this, there is a DVD called Wholpin, Wholpin. I tracked it down. It has like 8 short films on it, including yours. Cool. Columbia's library, Columbia University's library has it. That's how I was able to do that.
Thank you.
Now, first of all, was it hard to get Lauren Bacall, of all people, and Ben Gazzara to play characters who go out on this date?
Well, I was so lucky. I don't know what kind of crazy, you know, guts I had to even ask them. Thinking about it now, I'm like, I was 26, I think, and I wrote this this little short film, and I think that, you know, I can only imagine that they just were, I don't know, loved acting and didn't have anything better to do at the time, that they said yes, because, or were also, and also were incredibly generous with a young actor trying to make her first short film. And they were just so amazing, and both, again, sadly passed, but they were just incredible, incredible, incredible. And I mean, Bacall's comic timing was like just amazing. And yeah, it was a real, real gift.
But she, as most of you here know, was always a glamorpus. She was, you know, this stunning broad that we discovered into Have and Have Not, and then again with Humphrey Bogart in The Big Sleep. That last scene is, for me, amazing, you know, where a woman who's obviously been made up and had wonderful layers of adornment on her date removes everything and stares at herself in the mirror. Did this glamorpus actress have any reservations about that revelation?
She was amazing about it. She, I must be honest, she did not like me. But I loved her and admire her so much. She, which I like, kind of feel like she sensed in me what I learned later about myself, which was, it was really hard for me, which I found more on Tale of Love and Darkness when I started, that I had a really hard time saying what I wanted and being a boss. And like, it took me on Tale of Love and Darkness at 31 when I directed it, it took me a few weeks to be comfortable with saying, like, I want this, I want that. And when I was 26 on this with her, I did not do that. And she called me out on it and was totally right. It was totally right. But despite that, was a total pro, despite the fact that she was unimpressed by me, was a total pro, knew every single one of her lines, was amazing in every take, and did this very unvain scene where she allowed herself to be seen without makeup. And it was really, really magical, and was very much inspired by my own grandmother, who wouldn't leave the house without, you know, 2 hours in front of the mirror, putting on layers of makeup and wigs and lashes and jewelry and perfume and, like, you know, the kind of grandmother that you, like, kind of don't really want to kiss because you'll break out afterwards because she's got so much gunk on her face and your skin is a teenager's. But it was very much inspired by her, and she really went for it.
Wow. And by the way, when you talked about what Mike Nichols, you know, said about your voice and to try to make it more adult, Lauren Bacall is, of course, the one about whom the great legend goes, I guess it's true, that Howard Hawks, when he first met her, and she was a model for Harper's Bazaar, allegedly her voice was this high, thin squeak, and he had her bellowing everything, newspapers, Shakespeare, to try to get her voice down to what he thought was natural for her. And she finally developed that husky voice.
But wow.
From what I understand, she never had that voice to begin with.
Wow. Well, that's inspiring.
Yeah.
Maybe one day I'll talk like that too.
Cigarettes and whiskey, girl. Okay, so then you went on to do a short for New York I Love You called Manny. And I actually quite loved this as well. And we have two short clips from it. Set in Central Park, a little girl, and you cast the Cuban ballet star Carlos Acosta as the gentleman. I really appreciated how here you were playing with misperceptions and a child's perspective, which I think also feeds into A Tale of Love and Darkness. The idea of a male nanny, Manny, but then you hear the child saying daddy at the end. This was 2-3 years before Black Swan, if I remember correctly, but you already had the idea of a dancer as a primary?
I always loved dance. It's funny to see it. It's like, I don't know, there's some things that you make when you're young that you're just like, oh my God, what is that? But he's amazing. He's one of the great dancers in the world, and he was actually a really wonderful actor. And it was based on a story, actually, that a friend of mine had, where he went to the park with his daughter and someone thought he was the nanny because he was, you know, a black man with a white child, which, you know, happens, and someone thought he was the nanny, and it was the year of the Hillary Obama race, and I was like, oh, it's so interesting that people were able to make the, like, gender, like, leap before they were able to make the race leap with that, in that situation, because they thought that a man would be a nanny before a black man would have a white child, in that case. But it's a little bit too, like, I don't know, like, gimmicky or something as a film. But he's an amazing amazing artist, amazing dancer, and is doing incredible. He's a Cuban dancer, many of you probably know this, who is a star at the Royal Ballet in London, who I was introduced to by friends. And he is now going back to Cuba and starting this incredible program. My husband and I just toured, where they're renovating this old art school that Che and Fidel had, like, built as 20-year-olds or whatever, that has these incredible theaters and campuses that have kind of gone to ruin, and he has a company there, and he's incredibly talented.
And is it true that the directors of New York I Love You segments were given only 2 days to shoot and 7 days to edit?
Yes. It was very short. But, I mean, it's a 4-minute short or something.
No, it's longer than that.
it's not impossible, but it was pretty chaotic. Because we also had, like, it was like April in New York, and there was, the weather was changing and the light was changing like every 10 minutes, and my DP was developing a drinking problem from the weather. it was like, this is impossible.
Well, I mean, I've wanted everyone to see these clips because it places in relief the way that the building blocks to A Tale of Love and Darkness. We're obviously not seeing the film tonight. You can do that as of tomorrow at the Landmark Sunshine. But this is your feature directorial debut. And as opposed to taking something small, compact, like the two shorts we've just seen, Amos Oz's memoir, his novel, is 600 pages. It was an extraordinary success in 2004. And yet you tackled this story of the beginning of the State of Israel through the eyes of a family, a child, a 10-year-old boy who loves his mother, Fania, but that mother who has come from Eastern Europe with dreams, perhaps nurtured by romantic mythology rather than reality, is having a very hard time adjusting. Could you tell us, before we see any clips, a little about not only what it is that drew you to this for your directorial debut, but what were the greatest challenges? I mean, was it simply the fact that this was a 600-page sprawling memoir that you wanted to tell in under 2 hours, or were there others?
Well, the book was immediately, for me, as soon as I read it, when it came out in translation, which actually my dad reminded me that he brought me a copy after a reading that Amos did here.
At 92Y.
A long time ago, and got and had Amos signed to me, which I didn't realize the 92nd Street Y was, I didn't remember that detail of the story. But I read it, and immediately I visualized a film. And it was the first time that I had visualized a whole film. And I think, of course, that has so much to do with Amos's writing and how evocative it is. But I think there were other aspects that really captured my imagination. Of course, this relationship between a mother and a son was the central emotional pull. The historical and geographical setting, of course, being Israel / pre-state Israel, under Palestine, under the British mandate, has figured so deeply in my imagination from the time I was a kid, from all the stories I heard about my paternal grandparents moving from Eastern Europe to Palestine in the late 30s, and what that transition was like, and having been essentially orphaned, and being in a country of orphans, creating this sort of utopian dream together, that of course wasn't what it seemed from afar. And then also the language itself, which became a sort of obsession for me, that Oz really dives into so much, that what was this moment like when you have people from all of these different countries reviving what had not been a spoken language, what had only been used for religious purposes for hundreds of years, and then to have to say, let's go fill up the car with gas in that language, how do you modernize it? And finding these etymological games between, biblical words, and also how the modern architects of modern Hebrew found ways to say frustration from biblical terms, or computer from biblical words. And what an exciting time to be a writer when you can literally invent the language.
Obviously, this had to be in Hebrew, right? There was no question that this would be adapted into an English language film. Did that pose, maybe I should ask another question first. Would you have been able to direct this film, would you have gotten the money had you not starred in it?
No. Originally, I wanted to just direct the film, and I tried and tried and tried, saying, I would put a wonderful Israeli actress in it, even a successful Israeli actress, and it was not possible. I think because it was my first film, they just needed some element that showed them that it would possibly make its money back. And so enough time went by that, because I started obviously thinking about it around 27 or so, and enough time went by that I was kind of old enough to play the part with, you know, a 12-year-old child by the end of the movie, that it kind of worked out.
And did you have to learn a better Hebrew than you already spoke? And actually, there's another issue here. You're supposed to be speaking the Hebrew of a young woman who has emigrated from Eastern Europe, from Rovno, in terms of where it was in Poland before the war. Now it's Rivne in Ukraine, right?
Right. It's complicated. Geography, always. Actually, my Hebrew teacher from Salman Schechter is here tonight. Ofra is
Ofra. Can we get a little more light in this hall, please? A little more light. Hebrew teacher, raise hand, please, if you are here.
Oh, did she stand me up? She stood me up, guys. Oh, hi. My friend Julie from Salman Schechter is right here.
Well, at least we can see who is here.
So I moved here when I was 3 from Israel, and then went to Salman Schechter until I was 12 or 13, whatever. Right, I switched right before 8th grade. So that was how I learned how to read and write and sort of kept up my Hebrew. But, you know, my grammar was poor, my vocabulary was poor, and my accent was also poor. So, you know, not great overall, but I could like communicate, just no one would ever mistake me for an Israeli. And originally for the film, I thought, I think my confidence level of my language was a little higher than reality. And I was like, I'm gonna learn a Polish accent in Hebrew and do Hebrew with Polish accent. And I met with the coach, Netza Riskin, who actually plays a part in the movie, who's a great actress in Israel. And she was like, no, we're not doing that. We're just gonna focus on making you not sound American, which was a great goal. So she really worked on sort of, especially because, with the entire cast, we didn't want to have everyone doing accents the whole time, because for Israelis, that would be really off-putting and almost theatery to have these sort of like Russian accents, Polish accents, and Israelis doing them. You know, it would have been, I think, much more uneven, instead of just, I think when everyone has kind of an Israeli baseline, then with, you know, a couple tinges here and there with certain characters, it gives you kind of, you know, don't pay attention to it as much. So yeah, so we worked on, the big thing for me was the Americanism in my speech was the es, that we have a lot of like sefer, which is book. We would say like sefer. You know, and in Hebrew, there is no like, there's no like schwa, like, so everything is, and she, Netta taught me like the best thing to figure out in a language is what people say when they pause. So we go, and Israelis go, and she was like, we just did all day long. So it was like, sefer, seder, like how we say the Seder, like Passover Seder, seder. Seder, sefer, gezer. It's like all like So that was the big one for me to overcome. That was the kind of American giveaway.
And we are so fortunate that Amos Oz is still with us. In fact, he's going to be reading at the Y again in about 2 months. Did you consult with him either in writing the screenplay or in shooting? Did he visit the set, for example?
Yeah, I consulted with him a lot and was, of course, the first time I met him was asking for permission to make a film of his book, and he was incredibly generous and wonderful in giving me the permission for, again, no apparent reason, because I had nothing to show for myself. But he asked me 2 things. One was, don't explain why my mother behaved the way she behaved. His mother has sort of depressive nature in the film. And he said that previous people who had asked him for permission to adapt the film into a screenplay had submitted screenplays to him where they gave like kind of pop psych. You know, she had a boyfriend who she really loved in Poland who was killed and now she can't go on with her life or something. So he said, please don't do that. It's a mystery to me. And still to this day, let it be a mystery. And the other thing he said was the book exists. So don't make a film of the book, make your own piece. And that was really, really liberating and generous of him to say. And then he showed me all of his family albums so that I could see the photos of his family, what they looked like, what they dressed like at the time, the kinds of things they did. He took me when we were location scouting on a tour of his neighborhood, and also because what used to be his neighborhood has now become ultra-Orthodox and you can't film there, he showed me streets that he thought looked similar to the way his old streets looked when he was a kid, that hadn't changed that much. And he gave me notes on, I would show him every draft of the script, and he gave me notes, but very factual, not, it wasn't ever trying to push me in a creative direction. It was like, you know, actually this date was in December 47, not February 48. And then he came to visit set once, but was too emotional and left. And then he saw the film with his family and was very moved and very supportive and thankfully really liked it, because that was the probably the biggest stressor of making a film about a real person, is to do the person justice that they, well, especially when they're your hero.
I mean, it's layers of the novel, but you managed to give layers to the film, because after all, Amos Oz wrote this late in life, looking back on his own identity as a 10-year-old boy between 1945 and 1952 in the fledgling state of Israel, close to a mother whose breakdown he was essentially observing on a daily basis, her headaches, her disappointments. And in a way, you managed to make a film that has the double perspective. You know, one could say that it is about Fania, the character that you play, whose identity dominates the film. But it's all through the eyes of her son, Amos. And of course, you realize from the frame of the film that it's narrated, the whole film is narrated by the voice of the aged Amos, looking back on himself at that time, looking upon his mother. And you find wonderful visual distinctions in the film. I'm gonna show one clip right now. It's this is Monk's story, for whoever is setting this up. And that just gives an example of the way that the imagination is a main character in this film. It's not just Amos, it's not just Fania and Israel and the father, Aryeh. It's also the way storytelling itself can be redemptive. This is the point at which I have to mention that the cinematographer that you so wisely chose to shoot the film is Slawomir Idziak. I know most of you have no idea who that is, but the Polish name refers to the gentleman who shot Kieslowski's Three Colors Blue and The Double Life of Veronique before coming to the United States and doing things like Black Hawk Down. Could you just tell us briefly how you worked with him in terms of distinguishing among the various layers of the film? There's the present, I mean, it's flashbacks within flashbacks, and then there's flights of imagination. And did you choose him on the basis of films like The Double Life of Veronique, I'm guessing?
Yes, well, first of all, I'm so lucky that he even entertained the idea of working with me on my first film. I mean, he's one of the best DPs living, if not the best. I mean, he's really, really remarkable. And yes, I'm a huge fan of Double Life of Veronique and Blue and short film about killing. I mean, I'm he's really a master. And I mean, his work in Black Hawk Down and Harry Potter is like, I mean, even the Hollywood films he makes look like art films. They're just gorgeous. And we worked really closely in pre-production, and it was an incredible relationship to be able to have, because he was both an incredible guide and mentor, but also really respectful and always listened to what I wanted and tried to make that possible. And also really always listened to me. Like if he suggested something and I said, no, I don't agree with that, we did what I said, which is really amazing for, you know, such a master to help an amateur make their vision. But having said that, most of the time his ideas, I was like, that's a great idea. So we work together, as he says, dramaturgically to before the film, really going through the script scene by scene, talking about it, talking about the different aspects. And I really wanted the reality of Jerusalem to be very bleak. You know, Oz describes in the book that everyone looked sick in the streets, that, you know, these were Chekhovian figures who looked like they were in their rooms, you know, reading all day. And when Slavik got to Jerusalem, it was his first time there, and he started doing tests, and he said, how are we gonna make this look bad? It's like the most romantic looking city of all time, you know, with the sun shining all the time, the stones look pink. And so he suggested this sort of green tint, which was incredible. It gave it exactly the look. It drained the color out of the pink walls, and which don't look pink to the eye, but on film in bright sunlight do, and made everyone's skin look very sick, which is wonderful. And then for these fantasies and stories, I wanted it to be much more saturated. So we obviously used a completely different color palette. And then the sort of memories of Europe, he also was the one to suggest, very rightly so, that it be a sort of blue, almost sort of like blue period palette, which was really appropriate because it's got this kind of cold but vivid and melancholy sense that really goes along with sort of Fania's romantic sadness about the past. So that was really incredible. And then he had ideas all the time about, you know, that about the ways we could shoot with glass or with from different interesting perspectives. That were really helpful and completely changed the way I understood storytelling.
Well, for example, I mean, I'm just thinking back, you saw where the borscht was served and the disapproving glance of the mother-in-law. It's preceded by these wonderful close-ups of the details of making borscht. I mean, I have never made borscht before. Now I feel like I could, because you actually see everything, and the way that hands are squeezing the lemon, and just that sense of detail, which I know is in some of the other work that he's done, but it also just makes you as a director seem attuned to every tiny detail as well as to the wide vistas, and it enriches the film enormously. We had at one point thought that we would take audience questions on index cards, but I realized that it's kind of getting late and there's so much that I wanted to cover of this extraordinary career. Instead, we're going to just show you two more short clips from A Tale of Love and Darkness, so that we can come to the conclusion of sort of understanding how this work came about. This is A Disappointed Mother and Dead Marriage. You get a sense of how it's a coming of age, not only of the boy, Amos, it's also a coming of age of Israel. You know, this is a film about mother and mother country in a certain sense. There's something very touching in the way that Fania is shown to be a refugee who cannot find refuge, not in her husband, not in her new home, not in her mother, not in her mother-in-law, but only in her son. Mm-hmm. There's the sense that somehow that might be what could save, if anything could. But you don't flinch from presenting the darker aspects. I mean, the beginning of the film tells us, the voiceover, as I guess the book does, that Fania died, that she killed herself at the age of 38. And so we watch the film already knowing that, and we're going to see how that happened rather than if. Did you ever toy with the idea of not revealing that? In other words, of not making it so much a suspense but a surprise?
Yes, I did. I went back and forth. It was in my original script that it's revealed at the beginning, and it is in the book revealed in the beginning. And I found that in a way it upped the tension because it becomes like a detective story in some way, you know, why, how, and that all of that sort of unravel slowly, and that like Amos himself, you're asking those questions the whole way through.
Well, I mean, one of the things I appreciate is what Amos Oz insisted that you do, which is to not try to find a pat answer. We always want to know if somebody, the horror of someone killing him or herself, why? And if one can trace it to a cause, somehow you can control it better. But the mystery of human identity, behavior, it's retained very, very much in this film. I am going to ask one or two because they gave me the question, so I can ask quickly. Working on film, do you prefer few takes or a lot of takes? And I'm actually curious even in terms of, you know, watching something like the horror of Fania hitting herself as opposed to saying something back to her mother, you know?
Well, few takes versus many takes. I guess it sort of depends what and how I'm doing, because I like when a director, when you've got it, that they know and that they move on. But I also like, if I don't feel that I've gotten it, to have as many as I want to get it. You know, I'd be happy to do 30 if that's what it takes, although I'd be also embarrassed that it took that many to get there. Because you know, you hope to be better. And then with some cases, like the child in the film was so instinctive and so incredible that I almost always used his first take. He was just right always the first time.
And someone asked, do you have an experience from college that shaped your acting career profoundly? Even though it was a psychology major, but okay.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, of course, as a whole, you know, I grew up a lot, I think. But I think probably I took a class with Jory Graham, the great poet, at school. And I remember we had to write like 5 poems a week. And then every week she would take one of ours and dissect it for the entire class, and treat it like it was a Yeats poem or something, and talk about the word choice. And when she did that once with my poem, I was like, okay, maybe I could make something that someone I admire would admire back. And it really gave me confidence to go into the world and make things. And that was definitely a really great gift from a teacher.
Actually, I feel I have to ask this last question. Was your experience directing this sufficiently gratifying that you now see yourself directing more films?
Absolutely. I really loved it, and I think that's really a testament to having an amazing crew and cast who made the entire experience from start to finish an absolute pleasure, and you know, really respected my authority, gave me everything, were so generous. And it's very touching when people give so freely to you of their own talents to help create your vision. It's kind of
Had spent quite a few years serving the visions of other great directors, and I guess you deserve the chance
to do your own.
I have at least 10, 15 more questions, but I know that it's getting late, and you've been very busy promoting the film the past few days. I'm just going to end by quoting from the very end of your commencement speech that you gave at Harvard in 2015. And you were quoting Abraham Joshua Heschel, and I just love the way you said that to be or not to be is not the question. The vital question is how to be and how not to be. And I think that your career so far, especially your directorial debut, provides a shining example to us of how to be.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.